Yeah, I'm leaving now. Alexander is working on his electronics. I think Sharon is resting. And Demetra, oh, Lord knows what she's doing. Can you believe it? I think she's learning how to drive. God help us all. Hello there. Hi. Welcome. Welcome. Yes. Once again, it is I, John Stephen Eftimiades, here to recap the year of 2012. And I cannot believe that once again, another year has come and gone. It is true what they say. The older you get, the faster and older you get. I mean, it just flew by. Okay. Well, I hope you had a reasonably good year. This year, 2012, like 11 and 10, I guess, had its ups and certainly had its low points as well. So, starting in the winter time, relatively mild winter, not too bad. But unfortunately, once again, Sharon had to go under the knife. This would then make her fifth operation and her third back operation. Around November, it started to get progressively worse. This time she had a new disc that herniated, a different segment anyway, and indeed pressed right up on the nerve root. To the extent, my goodness, that whenever she sat up or even stood for no longer than 30 seconds, she would become in excruciating pain, absolutely like a knife. She saw nothing but stars, all the stars, Johnny Depp, she saw Brad Pitt, Pee Wee Herman. No, not him. But you know what I'm saying. Really terrible, terrible, excruciating pain. She suffered terribly. Finally, in January, we were able to get her into the hospital. You can't believe what we had to do to get her into the hospital. And still, this rather incompetent orthopedist made her wait a week in the bed before he, was convenient enough for him to do something. So we finally scratched it and moved her to another hospital. Neurosurgeon, 24 hours later, she was beginning to get some signs of relief. Took several months for her to recover and really hasn't come back yet. But at least that excruciating, terrible pain that she was in has passed. The only other eventful activity that occurred during the winter months, my son, Alex, at the tender age of 19, was at the University of Maryland. He was studying physics. He was studying engineering. And he said, "Oi, forget the whole thing. I'm getting out." And he did. Walked away from a $5,000 scholarship. Oh, cardiac. Where's that AED? I'm going to need it. I think essentially he was just burnt out. I'm not sure. I'm not even sure he knows, but he just wasn't really able to focus and had enough college for a while. So I know that when I was involved with science as a young lad, I would spend the time, making things like crystal radios. Yes. And telegraph. Remember that with the telegraph? He spent the year pretty much doing computer programming for a nonprofit, as well as teaching himself electronics. A little more so than my crystal radio. He made himself an X-ray machine. And I insisted, though, if you're going to have an X-ray machine in the house to make sure that everything is safe, we need to have a Geiger counter. So he went and made himself a Geiger counter. And here you can see it now as you look.
You see it lights up.
One of the projects he did was very interesting was called a plasma speaker, where essentially electricity going between two points creates sound waves and reproduces the sound that's coming out of an iPad or iPod or laptop, etc. So the sound you're hearing, and I will shut up now, is actually coming out of that electricity. More specifically, the sound waves created around that electricity. Very, very interesting stuff. Really very, very creative. He's also goofing around with Tesla coils, which is essentially what he's using it for, is to turn electricity and send it out through the air wirelessly. So every now and then, when you're walking through the house, a fluorescent light will go on and off, you know, without a switch touching it. And you know Alexander's in his room creating things. So he kept himself busy. He learned a lot. And with any luck, he'll bite the bullet, suck it up, and go back to school and maybe get a degree and, you know, learn a few more things as well. And that was pretty much our winter, otherwise uneventful. Springtime, well, got to get into my spring clothes. Ah, well, there we go. Springtime. You know, springtime here in the Washington, D.C. area is rather enjoyable. Can begin as early as late February, maybe early March at the latest, and we get nice weather, beautiful weather, right up until about the beginning of June. And then all hell breaks loose and you get these hot, oppressive summers. But it's a rather enjoyable area to be in if you're going to come or want to come into the Washington, D.C. area around springtime. This past spring, 2012, I guess three things stand out. One was I've been in his home for 22 years, and finally, after scrimping and saving, I was able to do something about that god-awful kitchen that I have. I don't know why, but they put this dark brown, almost fecal color brown, disgusting cabinets, and green, like slime, lime green appliances. So out with them all. Got them all removed, put in some nice modern cabinets, a new floor, new ceiling, something pretty that I can live with, at least for the next year, because truth be told, I think I'm going to be leaving the area within a year's time. I think it's time to move on and find greener pastures, maybe in a warmer climate. So anyway, more on that a little bit later, I guess. But kitchen was changed, and that's nice. Another thing that happened is we took, Sharon and I took Alexander to Atlantic City. Yes, we thought it was our duty to teach him the vices of gambling. And so, of course, on the way, they have this wonderful outdoor chapel that is open to the public. You just drive up, go up to the, sit on the pew or go up to the altar and make your little prayers. And we ask the god and or gods to show us a favorable light on our way to Atlantic City. And of course, they're useless. I mean, well, what are you going to do? The house always wins. The house, God's strong, but the house is stronger. So as long as you can keep, a certain amount of money, in mind that you expect to lose, you'll have a good time playing. We hit the pool, we see a show or two, which is nice. And Alexander, of course, gave his best try at the $500 $500 one-arm bandit. Fortunately, it didn't work. Yes, he didn't have the money for it. But he played a little bit, and it was a good time.
Another $500.
The only other thing that happened in the springtime, which happens every spring, is Sharon is involved in this nonprofit organization called Pets with Disabilities. Now, this is a married couple, Joyce and Michael, that live on the southern shore, southern end of Maryland. And essentially, they've opened up their home. They made it into a sanctuary for animals that are disabled, animals that are deaf, blind, only have two legs or three legs, are paraplegic and run around in wheelchairs. So they do their very best to keep these animals alive where, other people would put them down. They have many needs, of course, as you can imagine, medical needs being the most, but they do their best to raise money. Sharon is very passionate about animals, and she took a liking to the cause. So every year, she rolls up her sleeves and dives in as they do their annual fundraising. She was able to get them this wonderful, wonderful venue, a vineyard, donated their ballroom, courtesy of Sharon's pulling on their legs. And, of course, she also solicits contributions from hotels, vacation packages, restaurants, things like that, and puts on an absolutely terrific silent auction. This year alone, I think they brought in over $20,000. So it's a wonderful thing. And the really remarkable thing, of course, is that Sharon is able to do this in a fair amount of pain. She's got constant back pain, leg pain, and she's absolutely wiped when the end of this thing is finally done. So, always hats off to her. They're very grateful for what she does, but I don't think they realize just how difficult it is for her to do this. But it's very dear to her heart, so she'll continue to do it as long as she can. And those were pretty much the highlights of the spring. Now it's time to get hot and dirty because it's summertime in D.C. Yikes. Yes. Hello there. Well, we're back. And as you can see, dressed for summer because it gets mighty hot here in the D.C. area. I don't know what you do, but for us, first thing in the morning, when it gets before it gets too oppressively hot, I like to take a run. And that's the one good thing that I enjoy living in this area, is that there are rather large parks with secluded trails, just perfect for running. And so, you know, every day, rain or shine, I'm out there 3 to 5 miles a day, and I usually take the pooches. And it works perfect because I can run and, you know, they're off leash. They chase the deer, they chase the fox. Eventually they catch up to me, or if they're running ahead of me, eventually I catch up to them. And the trails usually wind around and lead to a creek where they can kind of cool off. Or a couple of miles, you know, into the trails, there's a very large lake where, again, they can go swimming and such. Actually, Alexander and myself have gone swimming there occasionally, much to the chagrin of the ducks and the geese. Even though we do our very best to try to, you know, to fit in. Quack. Quack. Anyway, doesn't always work. As you'll notice in the video, there are three dogs. Two are really owned by Sharon and myself. The golden one, George. The black one, Cassie. The other dog is called Bentley. And Bentley is a geneticist's bad idea of a joke. It's a mix of a greyhound, fast as anything that dog is, and super energetic, along with a bloodhound, which means anything he sniffs, if he's curious about, that's it, he's gone. In addition to all the whining and complaining he does on a regular basis. Well, he is adoringly loved by, not me, but Jessica. Jessica Adamani is now a doctor of veterinary medicine. This is Sharon's daughter. And unfortunately, one of the significant things that happened over the summer is that Jessica spent a year in Canada doing an internship. She had graduated, was a doctor, and there she met a resident, a gentleman from France, who was studying for a year. And the two of them got to know each other. They talked, they, you know, split a coffee here and there. And, you know, next thing you know, anyway, so he suggested he very much would love her to come to live in France. And so, vive la France, Jessica was off to live in France. And of course, that's difficult on the mom who just would love to, you know, make a nest and take care of her for life, or to be near her for life anyway. But I think there'll be ample opportunities for her to go see her daughter and her daughter to come here with Mark. So hopefully they'll be happy. And we wish them well. And of course, the friends and family do as well. That's the downside that happened this past summer. But, you know, there's always a silver lining in every downside. And the downside, of course, rather the good side, is that Bentley is out of town. Yes, not only out of town, but he's out of the frickin' country. Oh, that Bentley. Constantly whining. How many, can't tell you the number of times we dog sat for that dog and nobody slept. But we'll miss him nevertheless, because he was a, you know, a cherished member of the family. Anyway, that was one of the things that happened over the summer. The other thing that happened, two other things that come to mind, Dimitra Eftimiades. Now, Dimitra is one of the daughters, one of the many daughters, if you can keep track, of my brother, Nick, the younger brother, Nick. Nick and Debbie have gone to live abroad. Debbie's already been abroad 2 years in Austria and then was able to transfer to England where Nick was. And now they're all living there. They found that by, you know, moving abroad, they can make much, much more money than they can making here. So they have ample opportunity to bilk the government out of even more money than they could here, and for working half than what they normally would work. So it's win-win. But all the power to them. Anyway, so they're there, and they got the keen idea of sending Dimitra here to go to the Montgomery Community College. And she is going there. She made, because she was such a good athlete in her high school years, she was able to make the basketball team. So she's playing college basketball, and I think that's terrific. And for what she reports, she says she's getting good grades, and that's good. with her background in athletics and sports, I think she wants to, you know, study boys, athleticism, maybe sports management, things like that. So we'll see what comes of it. But she's here for the year, and it's been an unusual experience for me because I, of course, grew up in this house with my son, Alexander. And so now we have a teenage girl, so it's a little different. The bathroom is a little bit different than what I remember it, but what the heck. She's welcomed here, and hopefully she's enjoying her experience at college. The only other thing that happened during the summer, which was of interest, were the Olympics. And we enjoyed watching them very, very much, all the different activities. And so to kind of pay tribute to the Olympics, we had our own little Olympic event here. And we wondered what we could possibly do because, given, interests we have and our athleticism, so to speak. So Sharon apparently spent many years studying and riding horses. So we decided to put forth a little bit of a competition where she was going to ride a horse. And Alexander trained a horse that we got into the living room, as you see. His name was Fancy Prance Fat Arse. Yes, and Sharon did her very best in getting the horse to perform dressage as well as to jump various hurdles. And you can see what
came
of
for the
whole thing.
Fancy Prance.
But it was a fun time, and we certainly enjoyed watching the Olympics, and that was great. So that was pretty much our summer, which, of course, leads us to autumn. I am back, yes, and I am in my fall attire. Fall in the Washington, D.C. area is really quite lovely. You get this nice protracted Indian summer, which goes from September right on through, for the most part, the early part of December. We're getting 50-degree weather consistently. It's really, really quite nice, and courtesy of global warming, looks like it's going to get better. I'm not so sure that that's a good thing for all of us. Anyway, in the fall, much like earlier in the year, we had good and bad. We did not go on a summer vacation, and to understand why, you need only look back at the spring portion of the tape. kitchens, require a little bit of this. And so between the appliances and the floor and the ceiling and cabinets and all that, we're not going anywhere. But courtesy of Groupon and some specials that Southwest Airlines ran, we were able to sneak away quite inexpensively, relatively inexpensively, to Niagara Falls. We decided to go there again. We'd been there 2 years earlier, and nothing changed. The falls are still as beautiful, breathtaking, as spectacular as they've been. And as you can see, just a lovely sight, as is the Niagara River. It is, to my knowledge, the only river that has a grade 6 rapids. So quite dangerous, but quite, again, spectacular to watch. We also partook in the Butterfly Arboretum. We'd been there before. I think this is my third time there. And it never gets tired. It's just butterflies from around the world, this beautiful complex. And of course, they're quite friendly. They get the up close and personal on you. And it's always a nice thing to do just to pass through and spend a couple of hours there. We did other things, the classic IMAX stuff and things around. Oh, there was a wax museum, which we hadn't tried. And so I spent a little time with old Michael J. Doing a little Billie Jean. Here's a sample, if you will. Another thing we did up there, which was quite different, was they have, Canada has their equivalent of SeaWorld. It's not nearly as large and as extravagant, commercial for that matter, as the one you find in Florida or California. This one is kind of up close and personal, and they really do go out of their way to get you to interact with the animals. So here you see Sharon making friends with the beluga whale, and they're really adorable creatures to watch. And also the assortment of black bears. They have this huge pen, if you will, with many, many dozens of black bears there. And here you see Sharon is feeding one of them and actually getting it. She's actually saying to give him your paw. No, give me your paw. Give me your paw. And you can see that, that as there as well. After the trip, which was rather enjoyable, it came around Halloween time. And Alexander started to go back to his little stash of thermite, and decided to have some fun with a couple of the pumpkins, and so some of the neighborhood kids gathered around to watch that.
What did he
and,
like to do?
Always a good,
like
good thing to do, a kind of a spooky thing to do, to set those afire. And, you know, you can see what he did there. And that was pretty much it. And then, unfortunately, as the fall progressed, Sharon, who'd been wearing a patch, a narcotic patch that she changes every week, nevertheless, the pain returned in the leg quite severely. So she did a trial with this implanted electrode, an electrode that is placed right on her spine, and got some relief. So we went, and yet, I'm afraid to say, had another surgery on her back, in which a permanent electrode is now embedded onto her spinal cord. The leg is better. The back pain is quite bad because the surgery was extensive, but I'm optimistic, the doctor is optimistic, and I know Sharon is as well, that the pain will subside over time and that we'll get, you know, it's never going to be pain-free, but if it's just manageable and she can have a quasi-normal life, I think she'll be very happy. I know I'll be happy with that as well. So that's what happened toward the end of the fall. And here we are at the end of the year. And once again, I'm saying to you that I hope that you had a good year, that you have good health, and that I hope, sincerely hope, that sometime in the near future I will be able to come and visit and see you as well. As I alluded earlier in the little tape here, that I am giving quite serious thought to moving. In fact, I'm quite sure I will be moving sometime next year. I haven't determined yet the place. I've got to get licenses in different states to give them a try. Carolinas, North Carolina, Florida, perhaps the Southwest. I'm not sure. But first to try the Carolinas and Florida first and see if I can find a different place. I've lived here long enough, 22 years now, 23 come January, and I get the idea, you know. I've done everything I can here, and I want, a little quieter life, a little prettier life. This has become, when I first moved here, it was very, almost rural, but now it's a clone to New York. Looks just like New York, like being in Queens or in Nassau County. That's enough. Time to get out and move on to greener pastures, as I said earlier. Anyway, I shall keep you informed and let you know what happens down the pike. And by all means, you can let me know of any changes that go on in your lives. I'd love to hear about it. And other than that, from my family to yours, I wish you all a very happy and healthy new year. Take care, everybody.